Although there are a few different cymbal manufacturers today, when one says the word cymbal, Zildjian immediately comes to mind. The history of this family business, which began in 1623, has been talked about and written about throughout percussion history. The Zildjian secret has a mystique of its own which inspires a fascination that all musicians have with this instrument. 1929, a year of surprises and ups and downs. Black Thursday and the market crash. Gene Krupa recorded Indiana and Dinah with Red Nichols' Louisiana Rhythm Kings. 1929 was also the year that Avidus Zildjian III entered the scene to completely revolutionize the design, crafting, and marketing of the already internationally famous cymbals which had been produced using the Zildjian family's secret process for over three centuries. 21 years earlier, Avidus III had arrived in the United States to earn his living as a candy maker in the Boston area. In the years that followed, Avidus bought his own candy factory and built a home in Quincy, Massachusetts. Then, in 1927, he received a letter that was destined to dramatically change his life and the world of music as well. The letter from his uncle Aram said in essence, "The time has come. Return to Istanbul and take over the secret formula." To fully comprehend this unusual edict, one must know a little about the background of the Zildjian family. Prior to the beginning of the Zildjian dynasty, cymbals had been used in the rhythmic music of Byzantine civilization and down through the Middle Ages to the era when Turkish armies marched to the beat of drums and the crash of cymbals. However, the modern history of cymbals did not begin until 1623, when an alchemist of Constantinople, named Avidus, discovered the still-secret process for treating alloys and applied his knowledge to the manufacture of cymbals. As his fame spread, patrons and guildsmen gave Avidus the name Zildjian, which meant cymbalsmith. In 1851, Avidus Zildjian II built his own schooner and sailed it to London, where he displayed his cymbals at the World Trade Fair. At the fairs of London and Paris that year, and again in London in 1862, cymbals bearing the name Avidus Zildjian won all prizes and awards for excellence. In 1865, Avidus died, leaving two sons, neither of them of age. The business and secret process therefore passed to Keropi Zildjian, a younger brother of Avidus. Eventually it came time for Keropi to train his successor in the cherished Zildjian secret. As he had no sons, he had to consider one of the sons of his deceased brother, Avidus. Harushin decided to pass over the opportunity of inheriting the firm from his uncle, and in 1910 waived his birthright to his younger brother, Aram. Because of chaotic political conditions in Europe, Arab was able to produce very few cymbals before failing health forced him to consider retiring. And, since he had no sons to carry on the Zildjian name, title to the secret therefore was destined to pass to Avidus Zildjian III, eldest son of Aram's brother Harushin. It was at this point in 1927 that Aram wrote to his nephew in America to offer him the company and the famous secret process. Understandably, young Avidus was reluctant to leave his adopted country and the security and happiness he had found in the USA. Also, sensing that a potential major market for cymbals already existed in America, he saw no logical reason to return to Turkey, so he persuaded Uncle Aram to come to the United States to retrain him in the art of cymbal making. So it was that in 1929, while Aram was still in America, that Avidus began making cymbals in a small plant located near his home and incorporated the new firm under Massachusetts statutes. Finally, his plant primed for business and a basic inventory of cymbals on hand, Avidus turned his attention to selling and ran headlong into the crash and the depression years of the early 30s. With the advent of talking pictures, the silent movie pit band market had all but collapsed. 18,000 professional musicians lost their jobs. School band and concert orchestra programs were severely curtailed, and the music business, as were most businesses, was in trouble. Fortunately for Avidus, these years turned out to be a blessing. And Chicago's South Side. In those early years, he established lifelong personal friendships with Chick Webb, Tiny Khan, Zooty Singleton, Dave Tuff, Cozy Cole, Gene Krupa, Kaiser Marshall, Jimmy Crawford, Ray Baduc, George Wetling, and other highly respected drummers of the day. These associations led to many, sometimes hot, arguments and frequent all-night sessions discussing cymbals. One significant contribution to musical history which resulted from these conversations was the hi-hat. During the mid to late 20s, jazz drummers had been experimenting with an afterbeat use of the left foot using the snowshoe pedal, which consisted of two hinged boards to which were fastened two small clapper cymbals. The top board was equipped with a strap through which the drummer placed his left foot. The device was placed on the floor and provided the drummer with an extra beat. From this evolved the low sock pedal, which was prevalent until a now unknown drummer approached the venerable New England accessory maker, Wahlberg and Aug, with an idea for a pedal device that would be high enough for him to make full use of both his left foot and his left hand. The idea worked well, and within a very short time, the high sock pedal became very popular. To quote drum veteran Jimmy Crawford, "I switched over to the upstairs pedal because the new beat was taking things by storm. It's the greatest thing ever invented. You can hold everything together with that snap." Avidus, quick to sense the possibilities brought on by this new invention, created larger and thinner cymbals with a deeper cup to replace the old, relatively small and thick afterbeat ones. They caught on overnight. The time beat was born and is now history. Joe Jones, then with Count Basie, and Gene Krupa are, along with Avidus, credited with perfecting it. During the post-Depression days, few big jazz bands survived. A bright side of this period was the ability of some band leaders, like Duke Ellington, with the great Sonny Greer on drums, Louis Armstrong and Noble Sissle, to survive by working in Europe. The fabulous Chick Webb was among the few New York diehards able to work regularly enough to hold his band together. In 1934, things suddenly changed for the better. Benny Goodman, armed with some Fletcher Henderson and Benny Carter arrangements, stepped out on his own as a leader. The golden era of swing was on its way. The on-top-of-the-beat rhythm of Goodman's exciting drummer Gene Krupa proved to be just right for the popular dances of the day like the Lindy, the Big Apple, and the Shag. Meanwhile, Count Basie was also coming to the fore with Joe Jones riding his top hi-hat, a style that was to later greatly influence bop. We'll be right back. Behind the scenes, Avidus Siljan had followed the trend and had turned his attention to satisfying the needs of this new rhythm. Both Krupa and Jones and other top swing drummers made regular visits to the Siljan factory. By this time, Avidus's ingenuity and range of beautifully crafted cymbals were world famous. Among those he designed and named include Ride, Crash, Splash, Sizzle, Ping, Swish. For the next few years, swing and the first revival of Dixieland were extremely popular. Bandleaders had great success with such recorded hits as Goodman's Sing 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 in 35 with Gene Krupa, Don Redman's Stormy Weather in 36 with Sid Catlett, Tommy Dorsey's Marie in 37 with Dave Tough, and Bob Crosby's Bobcats Big Noise from Winnetka with Ray Baduke. And in 1938, popular recordings included Joe Marsala's Woo Woo with the sensational youngster Buddy Rich and Ella Fitzgerald's A Tisket A Tasket with Chick Webb. ...1938 also saw Krupa starting his first band. Tommy Dorsey was tremendously successful with Dave Tough driving the greatest rhythm section that Dorsey ever had. Jimmy Dorsey was also going strong with Ray McKinley on drums. The war years were lean years for the Siljan Company from the standpoint of production. Both tin and copper, vital ingredients of the secret Siljan alloy, were completely under government control. Fortunately, directors of military musical units specified Avidus Siljan or equal on all requisitions, keeping a government-approved quota of both metals sufficient enough to keep a skeleton crew of skilled craftsmen busy. At the same time, Avidus miraculously managed to keep pace with a new development that was shortly to predominate the jazz scene. Most jazz historians agree that the cradle of bebop were the jam sessions held regularly at Minton's Playhouse on West 118th Street in Harlem. It was here that Kenny Clarke started experimenting with new rhythmic ideas. Clarke and Dizzy Gillespie were both in the Teddy Hill house band at Minton's at that time, and Clarke started to get away from steady 4-4 drumming. Leonard Feather, in his Inside Bebop, quoted Clarke as saying, "On an arrangement of Swanee River, I began kicking, playing offbeat rhythms. Diz was fascinated. It gave him just the impetus he wanted, and he began to build around it." Later, as Kenny refined the style, he used the bass drum entirely for special accents rather than regular rhythm, and used the top cymbal to maintain the steady four beats. Bop opened an entirely new chapter in jazz drumming. Sid Catlett, Dave Tough, and Cozy Cole were among the very few veterans who were able to make the transition from swing to bop. Max Roach and Art Blakey, greatly influenced by Kenny Clarke, were among the up-and-coming stars and were much sought after. With the shift to bop, drummers' cymbal demands changed too, and Avidus, now with help from his son Armin, bent over backwards to satisfy their needs. Armin Siljan made frequent trips to jazz centers in the Midwest and East, especially New York. During these trips, he would spend his afternoons exchanging ideas with drummers at such musician hangouts as Jim and Andy's and Charlie's Tavern, and nights at the Onyx and other 52nd Street clubs. Avidus did his part by playing host to the many drummers who were visiting the factory in growing numbers for advice and for new cymbal sounds. With the advent of bop, drummers transferred the timekeeping emphasis from the hi-hat to their top cymbals. The popular 12 to 14 inch top cymbals proved to be too small, so gradually the Siljans made them larger, but still fairly thin. As the new style evolved, thin cymbals failed to pinpoint the sound enough. It was then that Avidus created and introduced bop ride and ping cymbals. These larger and heavy and medium-heavy top cymbals were produced in sizes up to 26 inches in diameter. Gradually, the size of choice settled into a range of 18 to 22 inches.
I remember coming back after the war and seeing all the cymbals getting big. And it was an entirely new sound. Gene Krupa actually ended up, when he was playing in the Metropole, with something like a 24-inch heavy ride cymbal.
When Avidus discovered that drummers were attaching key rings and other paraphernalia to their cymbals for various effects, he introduced the sizzle. This was an 18 to 20 inch diameter cymbal of medium weight, in which holes were drilled and filled with rivets. Over the years, the sizzle cymbal has remained one of Avidus's most popular. By the end of the 40s, bop had taken hold. Bop-oriented arrangements, no longer novel, were in the books of virtually all big bands. As early as 1945, Woody Herman recorded Caledonia, Apple Honey, and other tremendous hits. His rhythm section, sparked by Dave Tough, utilized bop ideas with cross rhythms and suspensions. The 50s were years of transition and contrast, with new trends overlapping old ones, years of experimentation and revival. While bop, per se, had receded into the background, it had left its mark on progressive music. Miles Davis, with Max Roach at the drums, is generally recognized as the key proponent of cool jazz with his early Nonette sides on Capitol Records. In contrast, Stan Kenton fronted a 40-piece orchestra with Shelly Manne and later Stan Levy on drums. Small combos were in vogue. Roy Haynes, one of the most versatile and tasteful cymbal artists of all, played with Charlie Parker before joining a small group to back Sarah Vaughan. Gene Krupa reorganized his trio, toured abroad, and enjoyed enormous popularity. Connie Kay, with his firmly swinging but impeccably sensitive cymbal style, replaced Kenny Clarke with the Modern Jazz Quartet. Philly Joe Jones, Jimmy Cobb, Mel Lewis, and Elvin Jones with the great John Coltrane were among the drummers making legendary recordings during this time period. Miles Davis continued to push the boundaries of jazz with his legendary quintet featuring a young drummer named Tony Williams. Williams, having a foundation and schooling in jazz but an ear for rock, was to influence the shape of modern drumming during the next decade, possibly more than any other drummer. Rock and roll, in its earliest form, is played by Louis Jordan's Timpani Five, with Chris Columbus on drums back in the 40s, was a far cry from the overwhelming sound that arrived from Liverpool with the Beatles and other groups in the 60s. Once again, Zildjian was at the forefront of another music revolution, as Ringo's flamboyant style and distinctive ride cymbal sound inspired a whole new generation to start playing the drums. The demand for Zildjian cymbals quadrupled overnight as rock drummers stepped up the beat to quadruple forte on the ride cymbals. A bright and articulate sound was called for. The Zildjians wasted no time in providing the solution to the problem with their 20 and 22 inch ping ride and other medium weight top cymbals. Ginger Baker with Cream extended this new rhythm to closed hi-hats using 15 inch A Zildjian new beats. Mitch Mitchell used his new beats to drive the music of Jimi Hendrix. Other drummers jumped on the bandwagon, and Zildjian's factory-matched new beats became standard equipment almost instantly.
Louis Bellson, he's the beginning of the start of the new beat hi-hat, where we used a heavy cymbal on the bottom. And I think this completely changed sock cymbal playing.
With the transition of rock into jazz rock, groups added brass and reeds, electric pianos, and synthesizers. As a result, drummers like Billy Cobham, Lenny White, Alphonse Muzan, Narada Michael Walden, Danny Serafine, Bobby Colomby, Ayrton Moreira, and Steve Gadd began to look for high-pitched, slashing crash sounds. Strangely enough, they found their answer in the same 16 to 18-inch diameter medium-thin crash cymbals that Buddy Rich, perhaps the greatest of them all, Max Roach, and Louis Bellson had been playing for many years. In this time of constant change, drummers became more and more imaginative. Ginger Baker introduced a double-decker combination of swish and crash. Louis Belson, then with Doc Severinsen's band, followed suit. Keith Moon created a multi-cymbal setup and began riding on his Zildjian crash cymbals, breaking all the rules. In recording studios from Hollywood to New York, drummers like Earl Palmer, Hal Blaine, Johnny Guerin, Bernard Pretty Purdy, Rick Murata, and Andy Newmark were recording some of the most memorable and influential music of the period. As the music continued to evolve, Alex Acuna, and later Peter Erskine, charted new drum set territory playing with Weather Report, one of the most influential bands of the era, as the lines between musical categories continued to be blurred. To keep pace, the Zildjians, in addition to new beat hi-hats, brilliant and mini-cup rides, introduced rock hi-hats, rock crashes, rock rides, China boys, earth rides, paper-thin crashes, and quick-beat hi-hats to their vast line. The late 70s was to herald the coming of a new style of player influenced by the greats of both jazz and rock drumming, a style that can only be described as Steve Gadd style. Having forged his radically innovative concept in the studios of New York City, Gadd set the pace for many players who followed. This style created the need for more innovative products from Zildjian, including cymbals with less ringing qualities. A so-called drier sound was needed. At this point, Zildjian, now under the leadership of Armin Zildjian, expanded its already popular line of handcrafted K-Zildjian cymbals, which quickly won favor with jazz drummers like Tony Williams, Roy Haynes, Alan Dawson, Billy Hart, Elvin Jones, and Peter Erskine. Music was developing quickly in all areas, and rock and roll exploded worldwide. Great rock stars like Neil Peart, Simon Phillips, Joey Kramer, and Tommy Aldridge looked towards Zildjian for new sounds to meet their needs as their music evolved. This launched Zildjian into the era of high-tech manufacturing. Zildjian introduced the Z-Series, the first totally new cymbal design to be produced in three centuries using the Zildjian alloy. Z-Series cymbals were shaped by a revolutionary computerized hammering process that gave them a very distinct sound, a striking appearance, and an unsurpassable tensile strength. Zildjian followed up immediately with the creation of a spectacular new visual effect by finishing the cymbals in an extremely high silvery gloss finish, incorporating a special plating process developed in the Zildjian Sound Lab. This finish is called platinum. Funk, fusion, rock, Latin, and pop music all continued to grow, fueled by the 80s explosion in electronic technology. The new technology became interwoven with all modern music, creating another wave of new and innovative drummers like Vinnie Colaiuta, David Weckl, Greg Bissonette, J.R. Robinson, Omar Hakim, Kenny Aronoff, Jonathan Moffitt, Anton Figg, and Steve Smith. Once again, the new era of high-tech sound generation and recording techniques took Zildjian one step further by creating a demand for new products that would fill the needs of all these great drummers. With new manufacturing techniques and high-tech hammering machines, Zildjian designed a specialized line of cymbals within their K-Zildjian range called the K-Customs. Other innovative designs included the pre-aged Ks, EFX Piggyback, and the now legendary KZ Hi-Hats. Zildjian's innovations continued into the 90s, keeping pace with exciting drummers like Dennis Chambers, Marvin Smitty Smith, Trelock Gertu, Adam Nussbaum, Manu Katché, and heavy rockers Lars Ulrich, Matt Sorum, and Will Calhoun, along with influential new drummers Matt Cameron, Tim Alexander, and Stephen Perkins. Most recently, Zildjian's A Customs, Oriental China Trashes, and brand new Z Customs have radically reshaped the sound and cymbal setups of these leading contemporary drummers.
What we have to do is keep abreast of the music that's going on and the people and the drummers who are playing it. And this is how we're successful.
Zildjian also began to apply its experience and unparalleled knowledge of the world of percussion to the art of making drumsticks. Using its close working relationship with top drummers, Zildjian designed a comprehensive range of premium quality select hickory drumsticks. With its own 20,000 square foot manufacturing facility in Tuscaloosa, Alabama, Zildjian has direct access to the most extensive holdings of the finest hickory timber available anywhere in the world. It is the world's only fully integrated drumstick plant, with its own sawmill and kiln drive facility, affording complete control over every aspect of production. Today, certain phases of making Zildjian cymbals employ the use of the most modern techniques and equipment in the world. Armin Zildjian is convinced, however, that a large degree of personal inspection is absolutely essential in creating cymbals of Zildjian quality, each with its own completely individual voice. It takes 22 days to make a Zildjian cymbal. The special Zildjian alloy is cast from virgin copper, tin, and silver, using the same secret process discovered by the original Avidus Zildjian in 1623. Each individual cymbal is painstakingly heated and rolled repeatedly, cupped, tempered, sheared, shaped, hammered, and then exactingly lathed to perfection. Finally, every cymbal is meticulously tested by experienced drummers, and only then does it receive the Zildjian name. Cymbals and cymbal playing have come a long way since 1623. Today, mastery of the many techniques of playing cymbals is considered an art of the highest order. The world's finest cymbals are made exclusively in the United States of America under the guidance of Armin Zildjian and his daughters, Craigie and Debbie. As new economies grow and popular music flourishes in all countries of the world, the Zildjians continue to bring their vision of musical excellence and commitment to quality to drummers and percussionists everywhere.
I'm Marvin Smitty Smith. In this portion of the video, with the help of the Zildjian Company, we'll show you the basic components of a cymbal, the different sizes, shapes, sounds, and types of cymbals, and we'll show you how general manufacturing techniques can affect a cymbal's overall sonic character. We'll also cover cymbal selection, care and maintenance, and we'll give you some tips to enhance your cymbal playing. Throughout my career, people have identified me by and complimented me on my cymbal sound. I can thank the Zildjian Company in part for that, but I've also developed an ear to hear what a good cymbal sounds like. Having a nice sounding set of cymbals not only enhances your overall drum sound, but also the music that you play. Now, you're probably asking yourself, how can I choose a good cymbal? The first step is understanding how a cymbal creates sound, and then understanding the basic components or parts of a cymbal. One of the things to look for in a cymbal is the kind of harmonics it creates when played. A good cymbal should produce a multitude of harmonics, which will blend with the other instruments you're playing with. Although the way a cymbal produces sound is very complex, there are some basic elements of design that influence the sound characteristics. There are three main playing areas of a cymbal, and they are the bell, the main body, and the edge. Understanding more about these areas will enhance your cymbal playing. The sound that's produced at the bell will be bright and sharp, but it won't have as much sustaining power as the main body or the edge. This knowledge implies that the bell would be more suitable for short staccato rhythms, as in Latin, rock, and funk. The main body for more sustained patterns, as in ride cymbal patterns. And the edge for crashes. When choosing a ride cymbal, it's important to decide how much ping versus spread you're looking for. In general, a heavier cymbal with a higher bow will produce a more ping sound, like the ping ride. A thinner, lighter cymbal with a flatter bow will produce more spread, like the light ride. We'll use these same two cymbals to highlight another consideration. The heavier cymbal will produce a higher pitch. The lighter cymbal will produce a lower pitch. Heavier cymbal, higher pitch. Lighter cymbal, lower pitch. Let's consider the size of your ride cymbal. In general, the larger the cymbal, the more volume it produces. In other words, a 22-inch cymbal will produce more volume than an 18-inch cymbal. This should be considered depending on the type of music you play and or the size of the band you're playing with. A cymbal with a higher bow will produce a brighter sound and a higher pitch. A cymbal with a flatter bow will produce a darker sound and a lower pitch. The ping ride has a higher bow, thus resulting in a brighter sound and higher pitch. The K ride has a flatter bow, which results in a darker sound and a lower pitch. So remember, a higher bow gives a brighter sound and a higher pitch. A flatter bow gives a darker sound and a lower pitch. The size of a cymbal's bell affects the amount of overtones it produces. A smaller bell will produce less overtones. A larger bell will produce more overtones. The flat top ride here has no bell at all. This will produce very few overtones. The mini cup ride has a small bell on it. This will produce more overtones than the flat top and add just a little more body to the sound of the cymbal. The ping ride has what we consider an average-sized bell. This will produce even more overtones and add more body to the sound of the cymbal. The rock ride has an even larger bell and will produce even more overtones and add even more body to the sound of the cymbal. The hammering process is an important step in the manufacturing of the cymbal. This process greatly affects a cymbal's sonic characteristics. There are two basic hammering styles. The first is a more random hammering style, which can be found in the K-Zildjian range. This produces a dry sound and dark overtones. The second is a more machine hammering style, which can be found in the A-Zildjian range. This produces a bright sound and high-pitched overtones. This is a K-Zildjian cymbal. Notice how it creates a dark or warm sound. This is an A-Zildjian cymbal. Notice how it creates a bright or high-pitched sound. Another design characteristic that affects a cymbal's overall sound is the tonal grooves. Tonal grooves carry the vibrations of the cymbal from the bell to the edge. A cymbal without tonal grooves will give a cymbal more definition. This is a design characteristic of certain new cymbals, like the K Custom Ride. The K Custom Ride has no tonal grooves on the top or the bottom. This produces more definition or ping. The K Custom Medium Ride has tonal grooves on the top, but no tonal grooves on the bottom. This will produce a bit more spread. The K Light Ride has tonal grooves on the top and the bottom. This will produce even more spread. Adding rivets to your cymbal will greatly increase its sustain. Here we have two K pre-aged 20-inch cymbals. This one has no rivets. The other one has rivets placed in the traditional manner, 6 rivets around the circumference of the cymbal. The riveted or sizzle cymbal, as it is more commonly known, is a great cymbal for jazz music. It creates a plush backdrop for a soloist to solo over. An alternative type of rivet placement is known as the cluster. The cluster is 3 rivets placed in a small area of the cymbal. This placement has been popularized by Louis Belson and Peter Erskine. Here we have 2 18-inch K rides. One without the rivets, and one with the cluster rivets. Notice that the cluster rivets add just a more subtle type of sustain than the traditional placement. I'd like to talk about playing time on the ride cymbal, starting with the jazz ride pattern. From its prominence in the bebop movement in the mid-1940s, the jazz ride pattern is an important aspect of your overall drum sound. The phrases that you play, or where you feel the pulse or beat, relies largely on your interpretation of the ride cymbal pattern. The way you interpret the jazz ride cymbal pattern will greatly affect your phrasing around the rest of the instrument. Every drummer has his or her own interpretation of the ride pattern. No two are alike. It becomes your signature. Right now, I'm going to demonstrate three examples of the jazz ride cymbal pattern. The first will be a standard interpretation. The second is where the lilt is played tighter or closer together. The last example is where the lilt is played a little more separated. Now let's look at a clip of Peter Erskine and check out the sound and feel of his swing. Now let's contrast Peter's swing with a clip of Steve Gadd playing with the Buddy Rich Big Band. Instead of using a syncopated or dancing feel on the ride, he uses the butt end of his stick and lays down a quarter note groove, which creates a very strong signature feel. Now I'd like to talk about the straight eighth note rock pattern. The straight eighth note rock pattern basically came out of the shuffle pattern that was in rhythm and blues in the early 40s. The shuffle pattern was literally straightened out, thus the term straight eighth note feel. I'll play an example of a few bars of the shuffle pattern and then make the transition into the straight eighth note or rock pattern. Sixteenth note rhythms were added into the eighth note groove as well, from funk music. The ride pattern is an important aspect in Latin music as well. It relies heavily on using the bell of the cymbal as opposed to the body. There are many different types of Latin rhythms, whether they're Afro-Cuban, Caribbean, Afro-Brazilian, or just plain African. Right now, I'll play a series of four different types of rhythms. I'll play a mambo, which comes from the Afro-Cuban, a naningo, or 6/8, which is African, a samba, which comes from Brazil, and a calypso, which comes from the Caribbean. Now let's check out a clip of Ayerto and his legendary cymbal sound, which he made famous with Chick Corea and Return to Forever. Notice how he uses a flat top ride to get a flowing and exciting signature sound. The same principles we've discussed in relation to ride cymbals can also apply to crash cymbals. The difference being that crash cymbals are played differently, and their function in the music is also different. When you choose a crash cymbal, you might want to consider the musical context that you're playing in. If you're playing a cymbal that is too small for the musical context that you're in, you'll probably tend to overplay the cymbal. You may even break it. As with ride cymbals, the larger a crash cymbal, the more volume it produces. Here we have an A Custom 19-inch crash, and over here we have an A Custom 15-inch crash. The larger cymbal will produce more volume. The larger the cymbal, the more volume it produces. As with ride cymbals, a heavier crash will produce a higher pitch. A lighter crash will produce a lower pitch. We have two 17-inch crashes here. This is a medium crash, and this is an A Custom crash. The medium crash will produce the higher pitch. The A Custom will produce the lower pitch. The A Custom crash will also produce with less effort as well. We can compare the same two cymbals for their decay. A heavier cymbal will have a slower decay. A lighter cymbal will have a faster decay. Heavier cymbal, slower decay. Lighter cymbal, faster decay. A crash cymbal with a larger bell will produce more overtones and a fuller crash sound. Here we have two 16-inch crash cymbals. One with a regular size bell, one with a larger size bell. Listen for the difference in the crash sounds. For the sake of the music and the sake of your cymbal, it's important that you have the proper technique for crashing cymbals. The idea is to draw the sound out of the cymbal rather than forcing it out. So it's better to strike a glancing blow rather than striking directly into the cymbal. The role of the crash cymbal is to punctuate accents in the music as well as to add color and excitement. It's helpful to understand what type of accents you'll be playing so that you can accommodate the right type of cymbal to those accents. For lighter accents, you can play smaller, lighter cymbals. For heavier accents, use your heavier, larger cymbals. And for definitive endings, you can play two crashes. The size of hi-hat cymbals can range from 10 inches to 15 inches. As with any other type of cymbal, the same sound principles apply. The difference with hi-hats is that they're played in pairs, so this opens up a whole world of sound possibilities. When you place a heavier or higher pitched cymbal on the bottom and a medium or light cymbal on top, this gives you a more pronounced chick sound. Zildjian developed the new beat hi-hats based on this very sound principle. The same effect can be achieved by matching a bottom cymbal from one range with a top cymbal from another range, such as the KZ combination, which has also become an industry standard. More volume and presence can be achieved by using either larger or heavier cymbals, such as the Zildjian rock hats. To demonstrate this difference, first I'll play on 14-inch new beat hats, then on the 14-inch rock hats. For basic timekeeping, there are two ways the hi-hat can be played with the foot. The first is a heel-toe technique, the heel being played on the first beat and the toe played on the second. The second way is to suspend your heel and play with just the toe. When the top hi-hat cymbal is played with your hands, the cymbals may be closed, half open, or totally open. In the swing era, drummers would play on both the top and bottom cymbals, like so. When playing a groove, the hi-hat has become an important independent voice. Foot strokes can be added to play specific parts, as in the Steve Gadd 50 Ways to Leave Your Lover beat, or to add color by splashing them together. Once you've chosen a set of cymbals that sound good individually and blend well together as a unit, it's important to consider the balance between your playing levels. If you play the verse of a song with half open hi-hats and then go to the chorus of the song on the body of the ride cymbal, it may sound a little weak and anticlimactic, like this. If you go to the bell of the ride cymbal, it'll complement the energy you created on the half-open hi-hats. The sound of the bell of the ride cymbal contrasts nicely with the trashy sound of the half-open hi-hats. Now I'd like to explain and demonstrate special effect cymbals. First, the splash cymbal. The splash cymbal is a smaller, thinner version of the crash cymbal and has a fast attack and decay. Swish and China cymbals have a unique sound all their own. With the upturned or flared edge, it creates a very sharp, trashy sound. This is a 16-inch China trash in a right side up position. This is a 22-inch China trash, which I have set up in the more popular inverted position. Another popular type of cymbal effect can be achieved by piggybacking, or literally placing one cymbal on top of another. Here we have a 12-inch China trash placed on top of an 18-inch K dark crash. Zildjian has created a piggyback effects cymbal specifically for this purpose. In choosing your cymbals, it's important to think of your cymbal setup as a group or unit. Each cymbal should relate to one another, and they should complement each other in the music that you make. They should create a variety of sounds and to be able to handle the range of dynamics and tonal colors in the music. Here are some considerations in choosing a cymbal. First thing, think of the musical context you'll be playing. Will it be straight ahead jazz, or heavy metal, or salsa? Second thing, think of the size or type of band you'll be playing in. Will it be a piano trio, or a big band with a lot of horns, or a lot of guitars and synthesizers with heavy amplification? Third, bring your other cymbals with you so that you can see how the cymbal you're choosing relates to the other cymbals in your setup. And don't forget, bring your own drumsticks as well, bearing in mind that a nylon tip will sound different from a wood tip. And last, bring a friend whose ears you trust very much. And hopefully, if he's a drummer, have him play the cymbal while you stand a few feet away so you can listen to your cymbal as a listener. Now let's look at a clip of Dennis Chambers. Notice how he uses left-hand crashes, and notice the angle of his cymbals. Now let's look at a clip of Omar Hakim. Notice how his balanced setup allows him to get multiple uses out of each cymbal. Here's a clip of another player with a very identifiable cymbal sound, Simon Phillips. Now let's hear from Kenny Aronoff about how he chooses cymbals for recording.
So basically, you know, in the studio, I use so many different types of cymbals, you know, or different types of ride cymbals, depending on the song. You know, if I'm playing in Nashville and recording with Hank Jr., or doing a ballad with someone like John Barry, or, you know, that type of ballad type music, I don't need hard rock cymbal. I need something that's going to be a little bit more sensitive and have more definition to it, like an A custom, or maybe one of the a medium ride, I play with a lighter touch. But when I'm playing like hard rock in the studio, if I'm doing like a Cinderella record, or even like a Mellencamp record, or something that's more aggressive, then I need a cymbal like a 21-inch rock ride. The way I choose a crash cymbal depends on whether I'm in a studio or playing live. Now live, when I'm playing with like John Mellencamp in the bigger halls, like, you know, 10,000 and up, I tend to use 19-inch crash cymbals, 19-inch rock crashes, because they're just more powerful. Now in the studio, that's a whole different thing. I'll use anything from a 14-inch crash to even a 20-inch like light ride as a crash cymbal. And it varies on the group and the song and the room and what other instruments are being used. Certain rooms will bring out certain frequencies. Certain rooms are brighter, so I'll go to maybe a smaller, darker cymbal, like a K. Or some rooms are dead and need, you know, a fuller sound, a fuller cymbal, something that rings and explodes. Like if I'm playing a real hard rock song, and they're really miking the drums in such a way where a lot of room mics are being used and they want the drums to really be explosive, well, the cymbals sometimes will be overbearing for the way they've, the way they've turned the volume up on the mics. So I have to use smaller cymbals so that I can hit them hard and not blow out the, you know, the speakers in the studio, or put too much volume on tape. And then on the other hand, you know, I can use bigger cymbals if they're not, you know, turning the volume up on the overheads or the room mics. So it really depends on the situation I'm in. I think the most universal and perfect hi-hat, if I was to pick one set of hi-hats, would be the 14-inch new beats, because the new beats give you probably the most dynamic range of any hi-hat cymbals that's made. I can play rock and roll, real aggressive rock and roll, and then I can tighten down and get very soft and play the very, very intricate stuff without it being like so metallic that you don't have some sustain to the cymbal. But that's not to say that when I'm in the studio that there'll be a song where I suddenly like to take a 13-inch Z bottom and put a 13-inch K top on, or reverse. And I will get different hi-hat combinations depending on the song, depending on the frequencies that the other instruments are playing. Because I want the hi-hats to, I want on tape all the little intricate things that I'm playing on the hi-hat to come on tape. And if you don't have the right frequencies or the right pitches of the hi-hat, then it gets kind of lost in with the guitars or, you know, maybe the keyboards. But I need the entire selection of cymbals, different styles and different sizes, to cover it all in the studio.
If you properly take care of your cymbals, they'll last a long time for you. One way to do this is to know how to properly mount your cymbal. First, you take a felt and put it on the bottom so that you can support the cymbal from the bottom. Next, you put a nylon or plastic sleeve to avoid metal-to-metal contact with the cymbal and the stand. Mount your cymbal nicely. Place a felt on top. And just lightly secure your wing nut on top to keep it from flying off the stand. Now, one thing you shouldn't do under any circumstances is to over-tighten your wing nut. Over-tightening your wing nut is the number one cause of cymbal breakage. So remember, just keep it nice and snug, but not too tight. Also, you gotta let the cymbal vibrate. Your hi-hats should be mounted properly as well. So make sure you have a felt on the bottom for the bottom cymbal, with the plastic sleeve between, and make sure you have felts on the bottom and the top of your top hi-hat cymbal. And make sure you don't tighten it too tight so it can vibrate freely. For cleaning new cymbals, try using a solution of warm water and liquid detergent. For older or very dirty cymbals, use a cymbal cleaning cream developed by Zildjian. And remember, use the cymbal cleaning cream sparingly. Less is more in this case. And by all means, don't use any metal polishes or abrasives which can harm the cymbal. When you're not using your cymbals, keep them in a cymbal bag and store them in a dry place away from extreme temperatures. If you're traveling by bus or train, a cymbal safe is highly recommended. If you're traveling by air, a flight case in addition to your cymbal safe or bag is recommended.
DCI Music Video, the leader in music instruction and the first company to release instructional music video, brings you the best. DCI Music Video, the first in instructional music videos.